This conference will now be recorded.
A very good morning to all of you. Today we'll be discussing about transverse lie and unstable lie. So what is the definition? Transverse lie is nothing but when the long axis of the fetus is at right angles to the long axis of the uterus. So normally it is longitudinal lie, where the long axis of the fetus is in parallel to the long axis of the mother is normal. But when the axes are perpendicular to each other, it is called as a transverse lie. Oblique lie. Oblique lie is that when the long axis of the fetus forms an acute angle with the long axis of the uterus, it is called as oblique lie. Because this oblique lie, when the patient goes into labor or when the labor sets in, it will turn into transverse or it will turn into a longitudinal lie. That is why the oblique lie is also called as an unstable lie. So when in transverse or oblique lie, the fetus is generally the cephalic pole. You know what is cephalic pole? There are two poles of the fetus. One is a podalic pole and another is a cephalic pole. So the one when the cephalic pole lies in one of the iliac fossa and the breech in the opposite fossa, okay, it is oblique or transverse. Oblique is only, I told you, because it is only temporary or shortly, because when the labor starts in, it is converted into a longitudinal transverse lie. That is why it is called an unstable lie. So here in the transverse lie, usually the presentation is shoulder presentation. So the presentation is nothing but what the part of the fetus which lie in the lower pole, that is near the inlet. So in transverse lie, the part of the fetus which lies near the pelvic inlet is a shoulder. That is why it is called as a shoulder presentation. Now what is the denominator? Denominator is nothing but the bony fixed point on the presenting part. No, so the bony fixed point to the presenting part is the acromion process. So acromion process is the denominator. So depending upon the position of the fetus, the transverse lie is divided into dorso anterior. So dorso anterior means nothing but the dorsal part of the fetus which is lying anterior. Anteriorly means towards the symphysis pubis. So next, another position is dorso posterior. So dorso posterior, when the dorsal part of the fetus lie posterior, that is towards the sacral bay or sacral promontory. Next, dorso superior. Dorso superior is when the dorsal part of the fetus is lie up. So it is called as back up. So back of the fetus is up, that is called as dorso superior. Next is dorso inferior, when the back of the fetus is inferiorly present, is back down. So these are the four types of position of the transverse lie. The incidence, usually before term, the incidence will be more because it can convert into a normal lie. So it is around 2% in the third trimester. At term it is very less, it is 0.3%. So 0.3% at the term is instance of transverse lie. So here you can see, so this is nothing but head, this is breech, right? So you can see the breech is in one of the iliac fossa. So the opposite iliac fossa is the head. Okay, so again see here, the breech is in one of the iliac fossa and usually the head will be always lower than the breech. Usually the head is always lower than the breech presentation. So here you can see the dorsum, this is the back part of the fetus is lying anteriorly. So it is called as dorso anterior position. So it is dorso anterior position. So what are the causes? So you can divide the causes into maternal factors, fetal factors and the pregnancy factors. So coming to the maternal factors, contracted pelvis, uterine anomalies means septate uterus, biconiate uterus, acute uterus. So those type of uterine anomalies. And it's unusual relaxation of abdominal wall resulting from high parity. So when it's a multigravular, more four or more deliveries, what happens? Abdominal wall will become lax and the fetus will be pushing forward. So what happens when the fetus is pushed forwards, the longitudinal axis of the fetus will be deflected and it will be not in alignment with the birth canal. So it becomes oblique, then it becomes transverse. So because in multigravida, this is usually common. And tumor complicating pregnancy, so lower part of the pelvic tumors. So in tumors, uterine anomalies, and contracted pelvis, what happens? Engagement of the fetus is delayed. So when there is no engagement, it is not fixed. So the baby will be liable to move. That is why it can go into transverse lie. Now coming to the pregnancy factors, that is in case of placenta previa or the fundal implantation of the placenta, what happens? Same thing, the engagement is delayed, right? In hydromnios and prematurity, what happens? The space is more. So the space in the uterus is more, so the fetus will be moving, and it can usually it will be an unstable line case of hydromnios. Okay. Next, coming to the fetal factors, so multiple pregnancy, fetal anomalies like hydrocephalus, tumors, neck and sacrocorrigeal teratoma. So all of these because of the engagement is delayed here. So in primary gravida with an oblique or transverse lie, or in a patient with recurrent transverse lie, uterine malformation should be ruled out. So suppose the patient previous history also she is having transverse lie. In a primary gravida, usually I told you the transverse lie oblique lie is more common in case of a multi gravida because of the relaxed abdominal wall. The fetus is pushed forwards and it's not in alignment with the cavity, pelvic cavity, or in the process of birth canal. So that is why the fetus is moved transverse. So if in case of primary gravida, if the patient present with the oblique or transverse lie, you should rule out the uterine malformation. And in case of recurrent transverse lie also, you should rule out uterine malformations, because this is a very rare, I told you in term 0.3% will have transverse lie. Next, how do you diagnose? So diagnosis by your simple clinical examination, you should diagnose. So before, so ultrasound is that it's a confirmation, but clinical diagnosis is also important when the patient comes to you. So if you see, inspect the abdomen, the uterus is stretched transversely, right? It is asymmetrical. So it is asymmetrical and it is stretched transversely. And if you see the fundus, so when you see the height of the uterus, the fundus will be lower than the period of gestation. And if you see the fetus, will be, the fundal part of it will be empty. There will be no fetal pole. That is inspection. Next, come to palpation. So palpation, you know, in an antenatal case, palpation includes grips. What are those grips? Leopard's grips. So you have four grips, right? First grip, second grip, third grip, and fourth grip. So first grip is known as nothing but a fundal grip. So when you do trying to do a fundal grip or the first palpation grip, Leopard's grip, what happens? You will try to, with your both hands, the palmar aspect of the hands, you try to feel the what is there in the fetal pole at the fundus. So you can palpate nothing. So you will be not able to palpate anything, okay, in the fundal grip. So that is means you will not able to palpate breech or head, because how the breech will be, it will be a soft, broad, okay, soft, broad part is there. It is suggestive of breech. If it is a hard, ballotable part, it is suggestive of head. So neither of these two you can palpate. Suppose if a transverse lie in fundal grip, utmost what you will palpate, if it is in the case of dorsal anterior, you will palpate the fetal legs in your fundal grip, right? Lateral grip. Now coming to the lateral grip. Lateral grip is now here. In lateral grip, you will on one side, if you take a midline, so on one side of the midline, you will palpate head. On the side of the midline, you will palpate breech. So soft, broad, irregular breech is felt on one side of the midline. And on the opposite side, if you palpate on one side breech, you will palpate on the opposite side head, that is smooth, hard, globular head, ballotable part, it is called as a head. So in trans, in lateral grips or the umbilical grip or the second Leopard's grip, you will palpate the breech and a head in case of a transverse lie, right? If the back is anteriorly, so if the back is anterior, it is dorso anterior. If it is across a long axis in case of dorsal anterior, and if irregular small parts are felt anteriorly, if you feel, it is called as dorsal posterior. So dorsal posterior, right? So dorsal posterior means the dorsum, that is back of the fetus, is at the sacral bay. Okay, you will palpate the irregular small parts in case of a lateral. Next, coming to the pelvic grip. So pelvic grip is nothing but you have two grips, right? Pelvic grip, that is the first pelvic grip, second pelvic grip. First pelvic grip is also called as third Leopard's maneuver, and fourth Leopard's maneuver is the second pelvic grip. So here in third Leopard's maneuver, what you will do? You will try to feel the lower part of the uterus by overstretching your thumb and the fingers. You try to feel the lower part of the uterus. If in a transverse lie, usually it is empty. it is called as NT. So here the lower board is occupied by the shoulder during labor, but we are not able to feel any part in the lower part of the uterus. That means suggestive of a transverse lie. Next, fourth grip is nothing is there, so that is why there you can appreciate nothing in the fourth pelvic rib. Next, coming to auscultation. So auscultation is by you have to hear the fiddle heart sound. So in auscultation, depending upon the position, suppose the dorsum is anterior, so that is the back of the fetus is towards a symphysis pubis, then the fetal heart is usually heard below the umbilicus. Coming to dorsal posterior, when the back of the fetus is towards the sacral promontory, you will be able to hear the fetal heart higher level than the umbilicus. So by ultrasound you will confirm the diagnosis. Okay, then coming to the vaginal examination. So vaginal examination, suppose the patient comes during antenatal period, during pregnancy, usually when you do a PV examination, the presenting part will be very high. Okay, next, coming to the labor, because the ill fit of the presenting part into the lower pole, what happens, the bag of membranes will be elongated. So the elongated bag of membranes will be there. And during labor, you can identify a shoulder by palpating the bony prominences like acromion process, clavicle, axilla, scapula. So these are the process. If you palpate any of these, then you will feel that it is, you will know that it is a transverse lie. Usually when the membranes are ruptured, you can feel the ribs and intercostal spaces. So because when you feel the ribs and intercostal, typically the feel is described as grid iron feel when you palpate the ribs and intercostal spaces. Sometimes what happens, the patient goes into labor, what happens, arm can be prolapsed outside. So the side of which it belongs, you can determine by shaking hands with the fetal hand. So you can see here, during labor, the hand prolapsed. So when you shake, if you have shaken the fetal hand with your right hand, then you are shaking the right hand of the baby, right? That is the thing. So then how you will confirm the transverse lie? Basically ultrasound. So ultrasound, you will confirm the transverse lie, will confirm any abnormalities of the uterus, you will confirm the liquor, you will confirm the placental position, because one of the causes placenta previa. So whenever the patient comes in labor, if you suspect is a transverse lie, don't do a PV examination immediately. First exclude the placenta previa and then only do a PV examination in case of a transverse lie. So courses in labor. So why we are worried about when the patient is in transverse lie? Suppose if the patient comes in labor, what can happen? What worse things can happen to the baby and the mother? So what are the unfavorable? Because when the patient goes into labor, you can see here. So when the uterus starts contracting, the shoulder gets impacted over the lower pole of the uterus. And when something is obstacles, the uterus starts to contract more vigorously, sometimes a hat can prolapse out like this. So there can be hand prolapse. And because as a presenting part in high, when there is rupture of membranes, there can be a cord prolapse. So when the hand is prolapsed, the uterus try to contract vigorously. What happens? They can cause obstructed labor. Usually obstructed labor is seen in case of a primary gravida. In multi gravida, what will happen? Uterine rupture can happen. So when what happens, the lower pole will become thin, upper pole will become thick. So the upper pole, when during contraction, the upper pole tries to retract and become short, and the lower pole will be thinned out, because to accommodate what is present in the lower pole, so to accommodate the fetus in the lower pole, the lower segment of the uterus will become elongated, accommodate the fetus there, and then it becomes at one time, the what happens, if it is a multigravera, it gives away. That is, rupture can happen and it leads to very problematic complications, leads to maternal morbidity. Anyway, the fetus will die in case of, usually in case of ruptured uterus, and it can lead to maternal mortality. In case of primigravida, what will happen? The uterus has to contract and retract. What happens? The uterus can go into inertia and it can go into ketoacidosis, maternal exhaustion, dehydration, ketoacidosis, sepsis, and last shock. So these are the things that can happen, worst events, if you neglect. So neglected shoulder is very, very dangerous. So when you don't diagnose and the patient goes into labor, it can lead to rupture, ketoacidosis, sepsis, and shock, and maternal mortality and fetal mortality. So the series of complications are obstructed labor, rupture of the uterus, dehydration, ketoacidosis, shock, and sepsis are seen. So these put the mother and fetus at risk. So this is an avoidable situation, right? When a proper supervision, you should avoid the situation. But however, now it is not that common, but it is still rampant in the rural areas of the developing countries where they don't come to hospital for delivery, and they most of them have home deliveries, and they will not diagnose. It is a transversal and the patient is left in labor and the patient may die. So these are the unfavorable events that can happen in case of a transversal. Now coming, what are the favorable events that can happen during transversal? The following the favorable events is, sometimes there is spontaneous rectification of version, very rare, and there is spontaneous evolution and spontaneous expressions. These are very rare. So what are these events we'll discuss? So what is spontaneous rectification? What is spontaneous version? Suppose if the patient is early labor and it is a baby is very small, it is a preterm baby, and the patient goes into labor and the it is having good amount of liquor. When there is a head or breach in one of the iliac fossa, when the uterus contracts, it may change into longitudinal lie with vortex presentation. That is called as rectification. Or it can change into longitudinal lie with a vertex of breach presentation. It is called version. So when the transverse lie is changed to vertex or breach, it is called version. So usually this can happen when the baby is small, when there is good amount of lichen, when the abdominal wall is, uterine wall is very relaxed. That is in case of a multi-para. It is rare, but that can happen. And what is spontaneous evolution? So spontaneous evolution is, this is very rare, usually very low birth weight babies, like less than 800 grams. And usually when there is a dead fetus, so when the fetus is dead, macerated, this can happen. What is spontaneous evolution is, so when the uterine contractions is strong, when the arm usually prolapsed, so the head is lies in one of the iliac fossa, and head lies in one of the iliac fossa, the breech and trunk, so the trunk and breech are forced into the cavity, the neck is markedly elongated. So what happens is the breech and trunk are expelled first, followed by the delivery of the head. This requires a strong uterine contraction. So the breech and trunk are expelled first and then followed by delivery. This is called as strong, when there is strong uterine contraction, this can happen. Understood, no? So what happened? The head is one of the iliac fossa, arm get prolapsed. So the trunk and the breech are forced into, so the hand is coming out because of the strong contraction, baby is small. The trunk with the breech will come out first and the neck is elongated. And when the breech and trunk are expelled, then the head will be delivered. This requires a very strong contraction. Next, coming to spontaneous expulsion. Spontaneous expulsion is very rare. It is usually occurring in premature and macerated fetus. That is called as fetus is expelled doubled up. So when there is strong uterine contraction, the dead fetus, what happens? The head, the chest, the head and the chest, the head will be compressed. The head will be compressed against the abdomen. So they both come very nearer. And what happens is the head with the trunk will become the presenting part, and the head in the trunk comes out. The head with the trunk comes out first. And then your legs will come last, feet will be last. That is called as, because a fetus is doubled up, it is called as chondroduplicator corpora. So what is the prognosis? So usually the transverse lie, because there is no mechanism of labor in case of transverse lie, when you diagnose transverse lie term patients, usually we go for a cesarean section because increase of maternal mortality and morbidity and complications with the transverse line. So I told you what are the complications, like if the patient is, suppose if there is a transverse lie is there, the patient is neglected, then in case of primary gravida, what will happen? It will contract, the upper segment will contract, lower segment will retract, and at last the uteri, the maternal exhaustion is there and uterus becomes inert, there is exhaustion, there is ketoacidosis, sepsis occurs. If in case of a multigravida, this transverse lie is there, what happens? The upper part will become thick and short, the lower segment will become thin and elongated to accommodate the lower, the fetus, the presenting part, and then at one time it gives away, leading to rupture of the uterus, that will lead to again shock, ketoacidosis, peritonitis. Okay, this is the one scenario. Next, the overall perinatal mortality is high because the when there is more amount of contraction, so what happens? There is tonic contractions will be present. When the tonic contractions are present, there will be the relaxation time. Usually what happens in normal pregnancy, there are 3 to 4 contractions in a gap of 10 minutes. And each contraction will last about 45 seconds, a normal uterine contraction, where the uterus will have time for relaxation. That will give a good supply to the baby and the baby will not go into fetal distress. So uteral to placental blood supply is maintained. But what happens here is the presenting part is obstructed, or it becomes in the pelvic inlet, it becomes obstructed. The uterus tries to contract very vigorously to relieve the obstacle. So something is there, the uterus thinks, and it tries to push hard and hard and more number of contraction with less period of relaxation in between. That will lead to fetal hypoxia and it leads to increased perinatal mortality, morbidity and mortality. So overall perinatal mortality is high in case of 25 to 50% cases. That is one reason. That is the relaxation is less and then more amount of tonic contractions are present. Another one is usually what happens? There is hand prolapse. When you neglect a shoulder presentation, what happens? The hand will prolapse out. And it is very difficult for the baby to deliver. At this point, with cesarean section, it is very difficult because the shoulder will get impacted in the pelvic inlet. So it is very difficult to deliver it. So more amount of perinatal mortality is there. That is why you have to, when you diagnose transverse early, you have to plan accordingly, meticulously, and you have to usually do a cesarean section. So now coming to the management. So how do you manage? So there are two types of management. So you can see transverse line antenatal period and during labor. So you can divide management into antenatal management and during labor. So antenatal management, when the patient comes to you, so you can allow or you can perform an external cephalic version if the gestational age is more than 36 weeks. So if the gestational age is more than 36 weeks, if there are no contraindications for a vaginal delivery, and there are no contraindications for due to an external cephalic version. So what usually contraindications for not doing an external cephalic version? So you should not do an external cephalic version in case of a placenta previa or a multiple gestation, or the patient is having uterine contractions, or the patient is having a comorbidly obese, and there is a what is this term? Fetus is not good. Like when, before doing external cephalic version, you have to do a biophysical profile. If the biophysical profile is not good, you should not do cephalic version. And when the amniotic fluid is low, or when there is hypertension, diabetes, comorbidity conditions, never do an external cephalic version. Or when there is a hemorrhage, you're suspecting any hemorrhage, or you should never do an external cephalic version. Any infection, herpes infection. So these are the contraindications to an external cephalic version. Otherwise, if you diagnose antenatal transverse lie and it is greater than 36 weeks, you can perform external cephalic version. So how do you, so external cephalic version is nothing but you try to, so you have to try to change the lie of the fetus from a transverse to a longitudinal lie. Suppose, so you can transverse to longitudinal lie, whether you can change into a podalic pole, that is a cephalic presentation, or a breech presentation. So you can turn, that is called as version. So external cephalic version. So how do you do is you have to see what are the contraindications are there. and then perform an ultrasound scan to rule out congenital anomalies. Also, is a contraindication. Congenital anomalies of the fetus, congenital anomalies of the uterus. So these are also you have to do, and you have to apply gel over the abdomen so that more amount of friction is avoided. Okay, and then you have to give an uterine relaxant to the patient, like terbutaline you can give subcutaneously, and then you can take consent from the patient that you have to tell her that I am doing external cephalic version because the baby in transverse line. You have to counsel the patient properly, and then you have to perform. Then after performing, so what happens if the version fails or it's contraindication? Suppose I told you what are the factors, are contraindicated factors. No, suppose they're contraindicated, you have to admit the patient 37 weeks. Why you have to admit the patient early? Because in case of a transverse line, there is risk of early rupture of membranes. Why there is risk of early rupture of membranes? Because there is ill fitting of the presenting part in the lower pole. So there is early rupture of membranes. What is the problem if there is early rupture of membranes? There can be cord prolapse because there is a gap. No, there is no engagement. There is no fitting of the fetal part into the lower pole or into the pelvic inlet. What happened? The cord is free there. No, cord can prolapse and it can lead to fetal morbidity and mortality. And you have to plan an elective cesarean section. Suppose if the baby is dead or it is congenital malformed, then you can allow a vaginal delivery very meticulously, cautiously, taking care. Because mother is also at risk. Suppose when the baby can be delivered by internal version, the labor can be avoided. So only one condition is there where you can allow an internal podiatric version. What is that version? So usually in a singleton pregnancies, internal podiatric version has no role at present obstetrics. So when it was a twin pregnancy, the first baby has been delivered and the second baby is in a transverse lie, then only you can allow internal podiatric version. You can do an internal podiatric version of the second twin. But there's only one indication you can do an internal podiatric version delivered. So these are things, how do you manage when the version fails? So external cephalic versions, when you do, what happens? I told you, you have to turn. You have to turn the baby into a longitudinal lie, vertex or breech presentation. Then usually what happens, there is failure. Again, when you turn the baby, again it can revert. So some of them, what they will do is they will just fix the baby there and then will start a stabilizing drip. They'll start a stabilizing oxytocin drip so that to stabilize the version, whether it is a breech or a cephalic version, they will stabilize the drip. That is, they stabilize the position, they'll stabilize the lie by starting a stabilizing drip. Or they will rupture the membranes so that the contraction will start. So these are things they will do in external cephalic version. Suppose you have done as external 37 weeks you have done. Again, it is because there is time you send home and again there is a reversion. You can again try 1 week later. Okay, 2-3 times you can try. But what is the problem in trying external cephalic version? There are also complications. So what are the complications that can occur during external cephalic version? So when you're trying to turn the baby from transverse to cephalic or a breech presentation, what can happen? You can rupture the membranes. So there can be rupture of the membranes, or when there is rupture of the membrane, sepsis can happen. Or when you're turning the baby, there can be cord entanglement. Okay. And sometimes there can be hemorrhage. So sometimes there can be hemorrhage going on, and sometimes the fetal heart can decrease. And one thing you have to remember before doing an external cephalic version, if the blood group is Rh negative, you have to administer anti-D immunoglobulin to the mother. So before doing an external cephalic version. Coming to the most important part is cesarean section. It is preferred method of delivery. So if any, the external cephalic version is contraindicated, go for a cesarean section. So what are the difficulties when you're doing a cesarean section? So when here the lower segment, because the patient is not in labor, what happens? Usually the lower segment is poorly formed, not in labor, and also the lower pole is not, the engagement is not there. The lower segment is poorly formed in these cases, and the fetus can be manipulated. So sometimes what happens, if you know that it is transverse less before putting an insertion on the uterus and there is no rupture of membranes, the Likert is adequate, you can try to manipulate the breech after opening the peritoneum. So before entering the uterus, you can try to turn the baby into a longitudinal line, and then you can give an incision and you can deliver by lower segment incision. So why I'm telling you is because in case of transverse lie, if the baby is dorsum is posterior, so when the dorsum is posterior, it's very difficult to deliver because you have to deliver the transverse lie by holding the baby's legs and then you have to deliver by breech. So when if it is dorso posterior, there are technical difficulties to hold the leg of the baby. That is why sometimes in case of dorso posterior, you have to give a lower segment vertical incision rather than a transverse incision. If it is dorso anterior, you can give a lower segment incision and pull that, take hold of the baby's legs and we can deliver the baby. But if it is a dorso posterior, dorso anterior, it is easy to deliver, but dorso posterior, you should give a vertical incision instead of a transverse incision. Okay, these are difficulties that you can encounter during cesarean section. Suppose when the patient comes as late labor, that is, late labor is when the patient is neglected. That is, the patient, the baby was in transverse lie and you did not recognize, or the patient comes from a remote area. Okay, they have tried there in the, at home and she was not delivering, more amount of time has passed, then they come to hospital. Then you should assess what to do. Suppose when the patient has come, if the baby is live, you should never try an external cephalic version late because already the contractions are started. Okay, when you do an external cephalic version during contraction, you will invariably rupture the membranes and you will have more complication. So when the baby is alive, when the patient comes in late labor, directly take her to the cesarean section, operation theater, do a cesarean section and save the baby and the mother. Okay, and then internal version. So internal version, I told you, there is no role of internal version, only it is recommended in case of a second baby transverse lie in case of a twin pregnancy. Then if the patient comes a late level baby dead, what you want to do? You can do a destructive positional decapitation, evisceration, and uterine cavity is to be exposed extra the rupture of the uterus. Internal version should not be done. Here also, when the baby is dead also, never do an internal version because you can rupture the uterus. Suppose if you cannot manage to do a destructive operations, so don't do harm, just don't do further harm, just take her to cesarean. If the baby is dead also, you should take to a cesarean section, so to save the mother. So this is how we can manage. So delayed cases are very, very rare nowadays, but delayed case of neglected labor will go into rupture uterus, and because the patient will be anxious, tired, dry tongue, dehydration, ketoacidosis, and they'll rise in pulse and patient will be severe pain. Okay, because the patient was in labor, the hand may get prolapsed outright and become swollen, edematous, and you know what happens when it is obstructed labor. Bandel's ring is also called as pathological retraction ring. You can see below the umbilicus and round ligaments standing out like ropes, risk of rupture. So these are the causes when there is delayed labor. So what do you treat? So anesthesia should be given. I told you, when there is a patient in late labor, when the contractions are started, never do an internal product version. Delivery by decapitation if possible, if it is a dead fetus. Explore the uterine cavity manner to see any rupture. Threatening rupture in partially directed cervix. You suspect rupture, don't do anything. Just go and take for cesarean section. So when there is rupture, sometimes you may need to do a hysterectomy to the patient. So before taking transverse lie to a cesarean section in late labor, you have to take the consent of a hysterectomy before taking her to section. This is very important. So hand prolapse. So hand prolapse is when the patient comes in labor. So when there's full dilatation, ruptured membranes, actively uterus, okay, under anesthesia, you have to do anything. Internal podal question, I told you, no role. In case of partially effaced, dilated cervix, normal acting uterus, good fetus, usually, if it is a case of second twin, under anesthesia, do an internal prolapse question to food and leave. If your baby is alive, do a cesarean section. So this is the chart. So clinical cause of labyrinth transverse lie. So most common is unfavorable. Favorable, very late. Favorable, I told you, spontaneous correction is there. Spontaneous expulsion, spontaneous evolution. It is very rare. Okay, so usually comes in a patient, unfavorable patient means late labor, or the patient has contractions have started, early rupture of membranes is there. When there is early rupture of membranes, there can be prolapse of the cord. So that is why if the patient comes in antenatal period, if you diagnose a transverse lie, you admit her at 37 weeks and plan an elective date. So don't allow the patient to go in labor if it's a transverse line. So if the patient was in labor, there is prolapse of the hand. Usually what happens, usually the fetus will die. And when this clot, and when there is clot prolapse, also the fetus will die. Okay. So what is the problem? If you leave like that only, you don't diagnose. There is contraction of upper segment. There is distension of the thinning of the lower segment. Formation of pathological traction ring. There is Pandel's ring. The patient will be dehydrated, ketosis or sepsis, and all this lead to maternal death and fetal death. Okay. So next is unstable lie. I told you unstable lie is oblique lie. That is oblique lie is that it can turn into normal. That is called as an unstable lie. So again, same causes. The causes which are common in case of transverse lie are same causes in case of the unstable lie, like grand mal, dehydramnios, contractile, placenta previa, pelvic tumors. So what are the complications again? Cord engagement, risk of cord prolapse, prenatal death. So how do you manage an unstable lie? At each visit, you have to see the lie presentation, and there is no contraction, you can try an external cephalic version and hospitalize at 37 weeks. So see whether there is rupture of membrane, because when there is rupture, there is risk of cord prolapse. After investigations, all you have to exclude placenta previa, contracted pelvis, congenital anomalies, then you have to do a PV examination, right? So this is the thing. So how do you manage? Usually in the case of oblique lie, if you want to go for a normal delivery, you can start a stabilizing drip. So stabilizing drip is when there is external cephalic version is no contraindication, you can try for an oblique lie, you can just try an external cephalic version and make the lie of the fetus longitudinal after 37 weeks. And after you revert or the version is complete, start an oxytocin drip to initiate the contraction so that your version or your longitudinal lie is stabilized there. And then when the contractions start, when the patient, when the baby is in longitudinal lie with the good contractions, then you can start low rupture of membranes. So low rupture of membrane is very important. So when you revert in the normal lie, longitudinal lie also, if the presenting part is high, then you have to be very careful. Very slowly you have to you should allow the amniotic fluid to drain, because when you allow the amniotic fluid to drain very fast, what happened? The cord may prolapse. So slowly you have to drain the low rupture of membranes amniotomy, and then labor is monitored for successful vaginal delivery. This procedure may be done even after spontaneous onset of labor also you can do. Now this is how you can manage oblique lie. Okay. Thank you.